The media today, unfortunately, are no longer spectators in national and international politics. They've become players. What the media say and how they say it has a very important bearing in shaping perceptions on Capitol Hill and on the conduct of foreign policy.
We are sadly bidding farewell to a number of excellent journalists recently, those who cut their storytelling teeth in the shadow of world wars, global conflicts, and seeking out those stories that were grounded in facts, detailed by the moments that changed their way of thinking and gave the world a view of how world leaders were thinking. Arno de Borchgrav led a life worthy of its own story. Soldier, award-winning author, war correspondent, and editor, a news career that spanned more than six decades. De Borchgrav was critical of the mainstream media, never afraid to question what others were inclined to believe. Newsmax TV's John Bachman is here with another look at the man that we had as a guest here on this show many times and who leaves behind quite a legacy. John?
He certainly does, Ed. And former National Security Advisor under Jimmy Carter, Dr. Zbigniew Brzezinski, said today that de Borchgrav had, quote, keen insight into the strategic conflicts that have been dominating the world we live in. And that's why we called him so often here at Newsmax TV to talk about these very important issues with him. It's not just because he worked as an editor at large for UPI and at Newsweek for a quarter century and was a founding member here at Newsmax. That keen insight came from into global conflict, came from his own personal experience and extraordinary life. De Borchgrav's family fled Nazi occupation to move to England. He then served in the British Royal Navy, storming the beaches of Normandy on D-Day. And after World War II, de Borchgrav used his war experience to get a job in Brussels as the bureau chief for UPI when he was just 21 years old. 3 years later, he landed that job at Newsweek as bureau chief in Paris, later became the senior editor there and held down that job for 25 years. And on a personal note, Ed, you mentioned you interviewed him. I had the honor of interviewing him at least a dozen times, and I was always struck by his foresight. And just listen to his take here on the situation in Syria and the danger of a re-energized Al-Qaeda and the other radical Islamic elements. And this was late in 2012 when our current administration was talking about the fact that Al-Qaeda was on the run and the war on terror was winding down.
They're certainly more powerful than they've ever been because they've got all these associated movements. They don't have any centralized control, but they have the same objective. The Al-Qaeda terrorists are in charge of something now the size of Texas. There's very bad communications, and nobody really wants to get heavily involved.
That was before everyone really had assigned a name to the group ISIS. De Borchgrav was critical of this administration's inconsistency when they decided to get involved with the no-fly zone in Libya. He said during that same interview that would be a disaster. We know that is true now 3 years later, but he has also been very fair and blunt with his criticism of foreign policy, hitting both Democrats and Republicans when they failed to grasp the unintended consequences of military operations. And over his lifetime of 88 years, de Borchgrav accumulated several honors and awards. The George Washington Medal of Honor for Excellence in Publishing in 1985, Best Magazine Reporting from Abroad, from Foreign Affairs, 3 New York Newspaper Guild, one award for Foreign Reporting, and a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Phillips Foundation in 2007. But Ed, it's hard to sum it all up with just those few accolades. I think he was getting the Foreign Legion honor there, one of the highest civilian honors that country can bestow. But always a pleasure to discuss things with him and always hear him make these projections on how things were going to be based on his prior knowledge of history.
You love hearing about the stories of these guys who were correspondents for many years. Apparently, he was submitting an expense report one time. He had a coat that was damaged because a bullet came through his hotel room and entered his briefcase, and apparently it also got into his suits. So he immediately handed in the expense report for that. And there was another time at the he charged Newsweek several hundred dollars for Sherpas basically taking their Jeep across a mudslide and a landslide area. He said, I had to pay them one way or another. Gave them the expense reports. They went with it. How can you argue when you see that on an expense card?
One of the great things about interviewing a guy like Arno is that, you know, off camera, you could talk to him about the stories that went into making those famous stories that he reported on. Those are just a few anecdotes. I remember one time we were talking about Iran and nuclear weapons, and he said, you know, it's inevitable. Iran is going to get a nuclear weapon, and I know so because the Shah told me it was inevitable.
There you go. See, how can you even question somebody like that with that much experience?
Yeah.
Wonderful man. John, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
My pleasure, Ed. And best wishes to Arno's family. Our thoughts are with them.
Indeed they are. We'll be back with the second hour of the Monday Midpoint Card. But let us once again just say thank you and pay tribute to the man who was here and leaves us with so many memories.